That's what's got to be in it.
What?
The Capitol Dome.
On paper?
I want to make that come to life for every boy in this land. Yes, and all light it up like that, too. You see, boys forget what their country means by just reading the land of the free in history books. Then they get to be men, they forget even more. Liberty's too precious a thing to be buried in books, Miss Saunders. Men should hold it up in front of them every single day of their lives and say, I'm free to think and to speak. My ancestors couldn't, I can. And my children will.
Mr. President.
Senator McPherson.
I desire to call up the report of the Committee on Privileges and Elections on the expulsion of Jefferson Smith.
Mr. President, I trust the chairperson.
I have the floor, and I'm about to ask for a roll call on the passage of the resolution without further delay.
Mr. President.
The senator can have nothing to say at this time. I would not be either in bad grace.
However, Senator Smith is still a member of this body, and as such has an equal claim on the attention of this chair. The chair recognizes Senator Smith.
Thank you, sir.
This, here we go.
Well, I guess the gentlemen are in a pretty tall hurry to get me out of here. And the way the evidence is piled up against me, I can't say I blame them much. And I'm quite willing to go, sir, when they voted that way. But before that happens, I've got a few things I want to say to this body. I tried to say them once before, and I got stopped colder than a mackerel. Well, I'd like to get them said this time, sir. And as a matter of fact, I'm not going to leave this body until I do get them said.
President, will the senator yield?
The senator yields?
No, sir, I'm afraid not. No, sir. I yielded the floor once before, if you can remember, and I was practically never heard of again. No, sir. And we might as well all get together on this yielding business right off the bat now.
Senator Smith, yield.
Yield how, sir?
Will he yield for a question?
For a question, all right.
I wish to ask my junior colleague this piece he intends to speak. Does it concern Section 40 of that bill, a dam on Willard Creek?
It does, sir.
Every aspect of this matter, the gentleman's attack on that section, everything was dealt with in committee hearing.
Mr. President.
I wish to ask my distinguished colleague, has he one scrap of evidence to add now to the defense he did not give and could not give at that same hearing?
I have no defense against forged papers.
Committee ruled otherwise. The gentleman stands guilty, as charged.
And this same man, Mr. James Taylor, came down here and offered me a seat in this Senate for the next 20 years if I voted for a dam that he knew and I knew was a fraud. But if I dared to open my mouth against that dam, he promised to break me in two. All right, I got up here and I started to open my mouth, and the long and powerful arm of Mr. James Taylor reached into this sacred chamber and grabbed me by the scruff of the neck.
The president is trying to blackmail this Senate as he tried to blackmail me. To prevent his expulsion, he would probably even try to hold up this deficiency bill, vital to the whole country, which must be passed immediately today.
Have I the floor?
Gentlemen, I have lost all patience with this brazen character. I apologize to this body for his appointment. I regret I ever knew him. I'm sick and tired of this contemptible young man, and I refuse to stay here and listen to him any longer. I hope every member of this body feels as I do.
Mr. President, what does the gentleman want of this body?
I'll tell you what I want, sir. I want a chance to talk to people who believe me. The people of my state, they know me, and they know Mr. Taylor, and when they hear my story, they'll rise up and they'll kick Mr. Taylor's machine to kingdom come. All right, sir, I guess I'll just have to speak to the people of my state from right here. And I'll tell you one thing, that wild horses aren't going to drag me off this floor until those people have heard everything I've got to say, even if it takes all winter.
Barnes speaking. Half of official Washington is here to see democracy's finest show, the filibuster. The right to talk your head off. The American privilege of free speech in its most dramatic form. The least man in that chamber, once he gets and holds that floor by the rules, can hold it and talk as long as he can stand on his feet.
I always get a great kick out of that part of the Declaration of Independence. Now, you're not going to have a country that can make these kind of rules work if you haven't got men that have learned to tell human rights from a punch in the nose. That's pretty important, all that. It's just the blood and bone and sinew of this democracy that some great men handed down to the human race, that's all. But of course, if you've got to build a dam where that boys' camp ought to be, to get some graft to pay off some political army or something, well, that's a different thing. Oh, no! If you think I'm going back there and tell those boys in my state and say, look, Now, fellas, forget about it. Forget all this stuff I've been telling you about this land you live in. There's a lot of hooey. This isn't your country. It belongs to a lot of James Taylors. Oh, no, not me. And anybody here that thinks I'm going to do that, they got another think come.
But those tired boy ranger legs are buckling, bleary-eyed, voice gone. He can't go on much longer, and all official Washington is here to be in on the kill.
Just get up off the ground. That's all I ask. Get up there with that lady that's up on top of this Capitol dome, that lady that stands for liberty. Take a look at this country through her eyes if you really want to see something. And you won't just see scenery. You'll see the whole parade of what man's carved out for himself after centuries of fighting. And fighting for something better than just jungle law. Fighting so he can stand on his own 2 feet, free and decent, like he was created. No matter what his race, color, or creed. That's what you see. There's no place out there for graft, or greed, or lies, or compromise with human liberties. And that, if that's what the grown-ups have done with this world that was given to them, then we better get those boys' camps started fast and see what the kids can do. And it's not too late. Because this country is bigger than the Taylors, or you, or me, or anything else. Great principles don't get lost once they come to light. They're right here. You just have to see them again.
I guess this is just another lost cause, Mr. Payne. All you people don't know about lost causes. Mr. Payne does. He said once they were the only causes worth fighting for. And he fought for them once. For the only reason any man ever fights for them.
Because of just one plain simple rule. Love thy neighbor. And in this world today, full of hatred, a man who knows that one rule has a great trust. You know that rule, Mr. Payne. And I loved you for it just as my father did. And you know that you fight for the lost causes harder than for any others. Yes, you even die for them. Like a man we both knew, Mr. Payne. You think I'm licked. You all think I'm licked. Well, I'm not licked. And I'm gonna stay right here and fight for this lost cause. Even if this room gets filled with lies like these. And the Taylors and all their armies come marching into this place. Somebody will listen to me.
Okay, just fainted.
Okay.
What's the matter?
I'm not fit to be a senator. I am not fit to live. Expel me! Expel me, not him. Will it damage the fall? It's a crime against the people who sent me here, and I committed it. Every word that boy said is the truth. Every word about Taylor and me and graft and the rotten political corruption of my state. Every word of it is true. I'm not fit for office. I'm not fit for any place of honor or trust. Expel me!
Liberty's too precious a thing to be buried in books, Miss Saunders. Men should hold it up in front of them every single day of their lives and say, I'm free to think and to speak. My ancestors couldn't. I can. And my children will.